Caroline Dickinson murder suspect, major breakthrough tonight. Landmine blast in Kosovo kills one British soldier, injures two more. And how Manchester United clinched the championship.
From ITN, the ITV Weekend News with Nicholas Owen.
Good evening. There's been a major development in the Caroline Dickinson murder inquiry. French officials said tonight that DNA taken from the prime suspect Francisco Montes in Florida was very similar to that discovered at the crime scene nearly 5 years ago. Caroline's father, John Dickinson, said it was a fantastic breakthrough, but he remained cautious. Here's Philip Raysmith.
It was the announcement reporters had been waiting all evening for, delayed for 3 hours as laboratory tests continued. Public prosecutor Yves Boivin announced that DNA samples taken from the prime suspect were very similar to those taken from the crime scene. Speaking in Launceston in Cornwall, Caroline's father welcomed the news but has warned that there are still many legal processes to go through before the case can finally be closed.
Wouldn't like to say anything that's going to prejudice the continuing investigation and the legal processes, but you know, we're very happy with the way things are at the present time.
DNA was taken from Spanish waiter Francisco Montes in Florida and compared to samples taken from the crime scene. He'd been arrested on a completely unrelated charge at this American hostel, but his name was recognized by an immigration officer who knew of the case. Tonight, French officials refused to name Montes, only saying they wanted to question the person held in Florida. They also refused to say whether they would make a formal extradition request. Caroline Dickinson from Bodmin in Cornwall was 13 when she was raped and suffocated as she slept in a room with friends at this hostel in Brittany 5 years ago. She was on a school trip. Her friends say they heard her crying during the night but thought she was having a nightmare. The French authorities were criticised at the start of this investigation for failing to find any strong leads. It looks as if tonight, after 5 years of searching, they may be a step closer to working out who killed Caroline Dickinson. Philip Raysmith, ITN.
A British peacekeeping soldier in Kosovo has been killed and two others injured by a landmine which went off under their vehicle. The road near the Macedonian border was thought to be clear and had been used many times in the past few days. Here's Annabel Roberts.
The Scimitar reconnaissance vehicle was blown off the road and onto its side. One of the three crew was killed, the other two injured. They were on a routine patrol on a road that's often used by peacekeepers in this mountainous region, a kilometre from the border with Macedonia. Just last month, there was fighting here between Albanian guerrillas and Macedonian security forces.
The vehicle was destroyed by what we believe is a mine. One soldier was killed, two were injured, and we are investigating the incident now. So far, we're not prepared to say exactly what caused it, but we're still investigating the incident.
All three soldiers served with the 9th, 12th Lancers and were based in Germany. The injuries sustained by the two survivors are not life-threatening. Their families have been informed, but none of the soldiers' names have been released. This is the second loss for British peacekeepers in Kosovo this week. 5 days ago, a military helicopter crashed close to where the landmine exploded. Two people died.
We've had a number of incidents that have caused casualties throughout the week. We're quite confident that those incidents are not directly related.
There are still many landmines here in the border area laid during the war in 1999. It's possible one of these caused this latest loss of life. Annabel Roberts, ITN.
The government tried to reassure people today about the landfill sites being put into use to dispose of hundreds of thousands of animals slaughtered because of foot and mouth. It promised strict controls, although public resistance appears to be growing. This report from Harry Smith.
The people of Halsley are very unhappy with the way we've been walked over and treated in the last few days.
Protests are growing around the country near sites chosen for disposing of animal carcasses. This was the scene in the Devon town of Halsworthy today, where families say they'll be engulfed in smoke if plans for a nearby giant funeral pyre go ahead.
If the wind goes in the wrong direction, this town is going to be full of black smoke, making it almost unbearable.
What goes up comes down. We've all been given a leaflet and it's frightening.
But this is the problem ministers have to deal with, and it's growing. With the number of carcasses lying in fields now more than double what it was 10 days ago, the government is looking at another 100 sites where it can bury the remains. Ministers moved quickly today to reassure local concerns.
those landfill sites have to be used quite rightly in accordance with the instructions that we receive and the advice we receive from the Environment Agency. We have to follow proper environmental and health considerations here.
William Hague, today seeing how some of the tourist industry was coping, again called for the army to take full charge of the operation.
MAF are, I know they're working very hard, but they're totally overstretched and are not able to deal with something on this scale.
There's been another setback in Northern Ireland. One confirmed case in County Tyrone and another suspected could bring the number of cases there to three. As a result, the Protestant marching organisation, the Apprentice Boys of Derry, announced they were calling off all their marches this Easter to help stop the spread of the disease.
The government still has one weapon it hasn't used in this epidemic, vaccination. Tonight there are signs that ministers are preparing the ground for a programme of vaccination in the worst affected areas. But officially, the ministry is still saying this is no more than an option which hasn't been ruled out. Harry Smith, ITN, at the Ministry of Agriculture.
The foot and mouth numbers are still going up on day 53 of the outbreak. The Ministry of Agriculture reported 14 new cases across the country. That takes the total tonight to 1,301. And today the Ministry was also investigating a suspected case of swine fever in Essex. The funeral of a black teenager shot dead by a white policeman in America passed off peacefully today. Hundreds of mourners attended the funeral in Cincinnati. Despite earlier fears, there was no violence. 19-year-old Timothy Thomas's death had sparked days of rioting and looting. A 16-year-old boy was among 35 people injured during fresh clashes between Israeli troops and Palestinians today. The fighting erupted when Israelis attacked a Palestinian refugee camp. It's the second time in a week that Israeli troops have entered Palestinian-controlled territory in the Gaza Strip. The fighting comes just days before planned peace talks. Russia's last independent television network was taken over today by a new management put in by the largely state-owned Gazprom gas company. NTV, which has often been a thorn in the side of the authorities, was taken off air midway through a broadcast. Here's our Foreign Affairs editor, Robert Moore.
In the middle of the night, new security guards were placed around Russia's last independent national TV station. And as arguments broke out in the corridors inside, NTV's new owners took control. In protest, some of Russia's most respected TV journalists made a defiant last statement for the cameras before resigning. They believe, and so do many Russians who have rallied to their cause, that the country's hard-won media freedom is being lost, and that the new owners, controlled by a huge state-run gas company, will no longer dare to challenge President Putin. The old NTV gained a reputation for courage and independence as it reported the many abuses and horrors that lay behind the Kremlin's war in Chechnya. NTV also probed official corruption at the heart of the Russian government. President Putin himself today, touring troops in Chechnya, says the takeover of NTV is a commercial dispute and has no bearing on his tolerance of dissent. It certainly seems possible the takeover will silence an important and critical voice in Russia. The Kremlin, of course, will be happy. But there are many liberals here who say that today's events have weakened democracy. Robert Moore, ITN, Moscow.
Now football, and Manchester United have won the Premiership for the third consecutive year. They beat Coventry in a midday kick-off and then watched their nearest rivals Arsenal lose all hope of catching them with a surprise home defeat against Middlesbrough. Peter Staunton reports.
There was never any question about the ultimate destination of the league title, but even Sir Alex wasn't expecting the prize quite so soon. Unlike many sides this season, at least Coventry didn't hand the 3 points over at Old Trafford. And if the Midlands team avoids relegation, John Hartson will be the unlikely hero. He gave Coventry the lead before United's Dwight York brought his team level. And then he put them ahead. But Coventry weren't finished. Hartson came up with an equaliser. But Gordon Strachan's team ran out of steam in the second half. Two late goals gave United the points. Giggs's long-range header, followed by a Scholes long shot.
Paul's goals. And he scores.
The manager was off to follow Arsenal's progress at home to Middlesbrough. And their shock defeat meant that tonight he's become the most successful manager in the history of English football.
But it just tells you about the phenomenal consistency of the players, the drive and the determination. And I think that is why they've done so well in the Premier Division since it started. But obviously winning the first one opened the door, and from then on I've never looked back.
They were singing the praises of another Old Trafford legend tonight. Brian Robson's Middlesbrough had provided United with their unexpected bonus. Now the champions have to go and prove themselves in Europe, which won't be quite so easy. Peter Staunton, ITN Sport.
In the Premiership, there were home wins for Aston Villa, Chelsea, Ipswich, Manchester United, of course, and West Ham. There were home defeats for Arsenal, Leicester and Sunderland. Fulham will be a Premiership club next season after they confirm promotion with a 2-1 win at Huddersfield. Fulham took the lead when top scorer Lewis Saha scored from the penalty spot, his 29th goal of the season. Huddersfield pulled one back, but Fulham's winner came with 5 minutes to go. Luis Boamorte, the man on target. It was the cue for the celebrations to begin. Fulham, for so long the runaway leaders of the First Division, back in the top flight for the first time since 1968. And Hibernian won their tenth Scottish Cup semi-final against Livingston 3-0. Motor racing now, and David Coulthard will be in pole position tomorrow in the San Marino Grand Prix. Coulthard finished fastest in the final qualifying session, just ahead of his McLaren teammate Mika Häkkinen. Williams Ralf Schumacher finished third, beating his brother Michael into fourth place. That's it. I'll be back with the ITV News tomorrow. Happy Easter. Goodbye.
Gas, electricity and telephone.
Good evening. Well, it's never going to get terribly warm this holiday weekend, but there are some positive points. We should see an increasing amount of brightness as time goes by. It's been a cloudy old day today, hasn't it, in most places? And the satellite picture shows why. That cloud is slipping slowly southwards, clearer skies to the north, and they're heading our way for tomorrow. So something to look forward to. That front by tomorrow will be bringing bits and pieces of rain and drizzle to the far south, but it should hopefully clear away quite quickly in the morning. Things brightening up here, and then we'll all see something of the sun, but that's not the end of the story. We will see some showers as well. Now, the heaviest of those will be in the north and the east of the country, and some of them could well be quite prolonged up over the high ground of Scotland. It'll be cold enough for some to turn to snow. So a chilly day in most places, that chill accentuated by quite a blustery wind. So temperatures in the far north, perhaps no higher than 6, as high as 12 across southern parts of England and Wales, 12. It's 54 Fahrenheit, not feeling too bad in the sunshine. On Monday, most of the showers should have died away, just still a few in the east. Then mostly dry, with some sunshine, those winds easing. Here's a summary.
Power Gen. Gas, electricity and telephone.
Central Weather, sponsored by Staybright Windows and Conservatories. The clear choice in any weather.
Hi, our region in detail now, and it's our neck of the woods that is seeing the cold front at the moment. It'll continue moving south through us during tonight, quite heavy rain for a time too, but the skies will clear behind it, leaving us with sunny spells and showers for tomorrow. These showers will be cold, blustery ones though, even some hail at times. Easter Sunday then having a few sunny moments, but Monday still promises better, not warm, but mostly dry sunny spells for Monday. Bye-bye.
The Central 10-Day Weatherline, 09063 66 60 66.
Ronan Keating, award-winning songwriter, voted most fanciable male, 6 number ones with Boyzone, and a quadruple platinum-selling solo album, all before the age of 24. What's next? Find out next week, performing live and an in-depth interview.